I'll call this city council special meeting to order. Due to the COVID-19 related precautions under the governor's directives in effect at this time, there will be no in-person attendance at this meeting, and those present will be practicing social distancing. You may view or listen to this meeting on your YouTube or WebEx. You may submit your written comments via WebEx or at cityclerk@cityofhenderson.com. And if you would like to speak on an item, you may do so via WebEx. This meeting is being video recorded and streamed live to YouTube. If you're experiencing any technical difficulties participating in today's meeting, you may contact 702-267-2300 for assistance. Madam City Clerk, could you please confirm posting and roll call?
Mayor Pro Tem, this meeting has been posted in accordance with Nevada Open Meeting Law. All members of the council are present with the, Mayor March is present via telephone using WebEx, and you have quorum.
Next on your agenda is public comments. This time is set aside for our first public comments section. At this time, remote participants should begin submitting questions or comments via real-time text through WebEx, or indicate that you'd like to speak about an item on today's agenda. You may also submit questions and comments via cityclerk@cityofhenderson.com. Due to the special format for this meeting, public comments will not be taken on individual items as they are heard. All public comments should be submitted for this public comments section or the public comments section at the end of the meeting. The representatives for Henderson Coalition for Responsible Government will be participating during agenda item S1 in regards to the petition they submitted. However, this section is for general public comment in regards to agenda items on this agenda.
Thank you. Madam City Clerk, have we received any comments or questions via email or comment card?
Mayor Pro Tem, yes, we have. We have about 6 letters, and I'm going to read them in order they were submitted for the items on the agenda. So the first one is for S1. And it was submitted by Cynthia Halley at 89074. Mayor, City Council members, and staff, the letter of insufficiency is in itself insufficient. The City Clerk received the petition in the form to be circulated for signatures on May 18th. Per NRS 295.061, challenge to description of petition, challenge to legal sufficiency of petition, in quotes, whether an initiative or referendum embraces but one subject and matters necessarily connected therewith and pertaining thereto, and the description of the effect of an initiative or referendum required pursuant to NRS 295.009 may be challenged by filing a complaint in the First Judicial District Court not later than 15 days. The City of Henderson had 15 days from May 18th to challenge the sufficiency of the initiative, including the effect. The City did not follow NRS 295.061 to challenge the sufficiency of the petition wording. The City Council does not have the authority to make the insufficiency determination on the initiative. That was for the courts to decide had the City challenged the initiative and description of effect within 15 days, which you did not. If a City Council had the authority to decide if the wording was sufficient, NRS 295.061 would give that authority, but it clearly states that a complaint must be filed in District Court no later than 15 days after it is filed. A challenge of the initiative wording within the first 15 days is to allow a change to the wording while still affording the petitioners to gather signatures with the revised text. For these reasons, the City Council needs to vote to not uphold the insufficiency determination by the City Clerk that was made in error and allow the question to be placed on the ballot in November. The City Council needs to look in the mirror and ask yourselves, am I going to ignore the very people that elected me, or will I stop and listen? Because that is truly what this is about. The 2,936 validated signatures on the petition are asking the City Council to let everyone in the city have a voice in this major project on taxpayer property with taxpayer funds. If the citizens are truly in favor of spending $42 million for a minor league hockey team, turning a park facility into an event center, and forever changing the character of the residential area as you believe they are, would you not be confident that a November vote of the people will be in favor of your proposal? You were elected to represent the voters, not special interests. The voters will remember that you rushed this project through without allowing them to have input on the project every time they see the event center. Is that how you want to be remembered by the voters in Anderson? The next is from Laura Sanchez at 89012, and this is related to S1. Mayor March and City Council members, I would like to tell you my personal story of attempting to fight Henderson City Hall and a multimillionaire. I thought the Henderson residents and voters voicing their opposition to the Arena Event Center would have some impact. It became obvious that you had already decided the fate of the Henderson Pavilion well before the Vegas Knights helmet smashed into it at the State of the City address. I was fortunate to meet a wonderful group of passionate neighbors who were equally as concerned as my family was about the choice you have made for our community without even a single word to us or our HOA about it. We thought we could influence you to consider another location. Then the world shut down. We thought you would reconsider spending our tax money on a want rather than a needs of a community facing a record unemployment and loss of income, hence the petition. I have serious asthma, but I put a mask and gloves, suffer in the heat, and participated in the seated and drive-through petition signings. I was blessed to meet a large number of Henderson voters who came out to sign the petition despite the pandemic concerns. Unfortunately, we were all confronted by the results of your public relations campaign against us. We used the Nextdoor app to initially figure out if there was any support out there for our cause, and then to advertise the petition signing events. There was a small group of posters who resorted to name-calling, lying, and constant harassment just because I was not in favor of your arena. I was told I was a liar, an idiot, had no humanity, and had no morals. As a result of their abusive bullying, I withdrew from Nextdoor and put additional security cameras on my home. We were cursed and received threatening gestures during signings. A few drivers used their cars as intimidation and sped through while yelling, causing us to have to jump out of their way to avoid being. Supporters of the arena were contacted and given merchandise by the Knights in return for protesting our petition signings. Police were called three times by arena supporters, and each time the police said we were doing nothing wrong and even signed the petition. If people did not want to sign, that was not a problem. Plenty of people did not want to sign. Many times we told potential signers to go home, do their research, and contact us later if they still wanted to sign. You have become insulated from the real voices of your constituents. Do not rely on feedback that you have paid for, such as surveys and public relations firms. Look at the numbers from your past election and factor an additional 3,003 unhappy voters. Maybe we are not so insignificant as has been stated. I am the one from New York down the street from the Nassau Coliseum, once home of the New York Islanders. This June, that billionaire owner decided he did not want to honor his contract, pulled out, closed the Coliseum, and now it sits empty. I say this is a final reminder that the owners are always business first. Sincerely, Laura Sanchez. The next is submitted by Rebecca Perlmutter at 89074, and this is also related to S1. Dear Mayor and Council, I would ask you to carefully consider in deeming the petition of the Henderson Coalition for Responsible Government insufficient. You will be discounting the 2,936 validated signatures over a technicality. If you read the petition, it is clear the effect will be to prohibit the City of Henderson from contributing, investing, or lending any of its revenue or assets or those of its taxpayers for an American Hockey League arena / Henderson Event Center at the Henderson Pavilion. I don't believe an effect could be much clearer, and it was encompassed in the body of the petition filed. As council members, you are there to represent the voice of the people. None of you were elected to your current office by more than 11,445 votes, and some of you were elected to office with as few as 7,115 votes. I believe 2,936 valid signatures would represent 41% of the lowest vote total and 25.6% of the highest vote total. Yet you are willing to disregard that percentage of voters to block the petition. I am confident you would have been happy to have those 2,936 voters in your camp when you ran for election. I think it is a sad commentary on your representation of those people if you choose to disregard their voice. The signatures were legitimately obtained. Signers were asked if they understood what the petition was about. If they had questions, they were answered, and everyone was asked to read the petition statement to make sure they knew what they were signing. There was complete transparency in the process. This was done with no campaign by a grassroots group of committed citizens in the middle of a COVID crisis following social distancing guidelines and working in 100-degree heat to make it happen. As representatives of the people who have an obligation to hear their voice and give them an opportunity of exercising their vote on this initiative, because you choose to move forward with contractual and legal agreements after the petition was filed demonstrates a lack of responsibility on the part of the city and willful disregard for the voice of the constituents. In item S3, you attempt to make draconian case for the financial consequences should this be approved by the voters. Should you not have considered an outstanding petition before you signed the contracts and legal agreements? Were you just so desperate to have Henderson associated with the professional team that you could not wait to see if the voters would actually support using their money on the private, on this private for-profit venture? I hope you finally demonstrate some interest in the voice of the people and overrule the insufficiency by the city clerk. The next one is from Jeannie Adams at 89074, and this is related to S2. Good morning, can you please add this comment to today's agenda? My name is Jeannie Adams. I live in Henderson at 890074, and I request my comments be read into the record regarding item S2 at the July 16, 2020 meeting. Dear Mayor, March, and City Councilpersons, I ask that you reconsider moving to approve this item in today's agenda. Basically, you are taking public money from your taxpayers and using it to fight against your taxpayers on an issue that is supported by a large percentage of Henderson residents. Starting litigation using the Henderson City checkbook to fight your citizens who are grassroots group with limited resources and funding is the worst public image you can create and will only shed negative light on the city council and their ability to do the job you are entrusted with, taking care of the residents of your city and acting in our behalf in best interest. We, the residents of Henderson, pay the salary of the city council and the city attorney. Moving forward in this manner is inappropriate. I respectfully request that you reconsider and please do not approve S2 in today's agenda. The next is from Janae Adams, and it is at 89074, and it's regarding S3. My name is Jeannie Adams, and I would like my comments read into the record for the special city council meeting July 16, pertaining to S3. Mayor Martin, city council persons. As one of the small group of dedicated citizens that stood out in the hot and windy parking lot of the pavilion for 4 weeks collecting signatures for this petition, I ask that you take into consideration that this petition was signed by multitudes of residents who believe you have overstepped your boundaries and are not representing your community in a responsible and well-meaning fashion. We heard time and time again from those who went out of their way to come sign the petitions of how angry they are with the city council's lack of transparency, dissemination of misleading facts, how not one person was contacted for the survey that you continue to reference to validate the community's interest and support for this project. This project was in the works months before the community heard anything about it. By the time you deemed it appropriate to let your residents know what you were doing, you had already signed contracts and began rolling the ball on this to the shock and frustration of so many who will be immediately negatively impacted for years to come. Mayor and City Council, you are relying on information, figures, and numbers from a world that stopped in March 2020. I challenge you to have these reports and numbers updated to take into account the fact that there will be no hockey games, no symphony, no concerts, no plays, no community events for the foreseeable future. Your fiscal impact states the event center is expected to generate annual economic impact between $17,200,000 and $26,000,000 from additional sales tax, business tax, liquor license revenue. If this is using the assumption that every event will be sold out with no social distancing required, are these numbers using the existing revenue already produced by the district and surrounding businesses, which will hopefully continue and will be a part of the event experience for many of those going to the arena? And if so, aren't those numbers redundant? It also states that the event center will support between 89 and 122 jobs, but is this assuming the property will begin functioning at full capacity from the start? Are these numbers in line with what's happening today in the job market? And is this assuming these people live in Henderson and will spend their money in Henderson? It also states that it is estimated to generate a one-year return on investment of approximately 106%. Again, do these numbers align with the economy now or last year when the economy was booming? And this also assumes that when we come through the COVID lockdown, everything will return to what it once was, which is a very dangerous assumption to make, especially using public money. By the city continually moving forward on this project, using public monies to fund a private enterprise and justifying it to the community with outdated facts garnered months ago, you are validating the appearance and behavior of a city council that is not in any way interested in doing what is good and right for the community. There's another paragraph that will be added to the record. The next one is from Jason Kareen Reimer at 89052, and this is also related to S3. Henderson City Council, I am requesting that this email be read into the record for the public comment during the live Henderson City Council meeting set on July 16th. Regarding agenda item S3, to be clear, let us review this petition language briefly. It says, the people of the city of Henderson do enact as follows. A new ordinance is added to the city of Henderson city charter that reads, the city of Henderson is hereby prohibited from contributing, investing, or lending any of its revenue or assets or those of its taxpayers for an American Hockey League arena / event center at the Henderson Pavilion. And the effect requirements, and in quotes or excerpt, a description of the effect of the initiative or referendum if the initiative or referendum is approved by the voters. We can't conceive of any clearer way to phrase this to add clarity to the intended effect of this proposed ballot question. Ridiculous. We find it outrageous that the city is even considering rejecting this petition because you say it does not meet the effect requirement. It was clear to almost every one of the people that we personally assisted in completing signing this petition over the course of 5 weeks. Very, very few of the people we spoke to were on slightly unclear about the language and effect that issue was fully resolved before they signed the petition. Why is the city of Henderson so desperate to keep this simple ballot question from reaching the residents and voters whose funds and land you spend and take? Are you not confident in the public survey you referred to about this issue? More wasted money. The city of Henderson accepted this petition on June 25th and posted it to the city website soon afterwards, acknowledging that the petition is a public document approved by the city clerk. The petition is clear in every way, and our small group of concerned citizens or neighbors has done everything we can to meet every requirement that has been asked of us by the city of Henderson. We ask that the city council vote to accept this petition today, and finally, let the voters decide the outcome in November. Sincerely, Jason and Kareen Reimer, 89052. And the last one is from Frank Halley at 89074, and it is regarding S3. The city's fiscal impact of the initiative petition submitted by the Henderson Coalition for Responsible Government contains a major flaw. It presents the gross impact of a new hockey arena event center to Henderson's economy, not the net impact. Since events at the event center are projected to mostly appeal to Henderson residents, there will be very little, if any, new money flowing into Henderson because of the project. This makes the net impact to the city's economy much less than the city is advertising. The impact statement posts that the construction phase of the event center will have an estimated economic output of $142 million. For material purchases to impact the city's economy, the material would have to be sourced from local merchants. It is doubtful that a significant amount of the material needed will be found in the city of Henderson. And if the material is not purchased in Henderson, there is no economic benefit to the city. Also, the construction contract was awarded to the Las Vegas office of a nationwide company. That also indicates that little, if any, material purchase will benefit Henderson. The labor portion of the construction has the same issue as all the labor being performed by Henderson residents. Any non-resident workers will take the money that they are paid back to where they live, and Henderson will see no benefit. Workers who are Henderson residents are likely to already be employed. Those workers work on the event center project rather than another project in Henderson, so the net benefit to the city will be zero. If workers relocate to Henderson to work on the project, the additional revenues so generated will be offset by an increased expense for the city, such as schools, police, and fire protection, and other city services. This means the net benefit to the city from workers relocating to Henderson is minimal also. The impact statement also claims the event center will generate an annual economic impact between $17,200,000 and $26 million from additional sales tax revenue, business tax revenue, liquor license revenue, and other economic impacts. Since the city expects event center customers to be Henderson residents, there will be no additional spending within the city, and thus no additional taxes paid to the city. People will choose to see a hockey game or other attraction at the event center instead of going to a movie, restaurant, or other Henderson-based activity. Without money coming into Henderson from outside, there can be no net economic benefit to the city. A more concerning issue is that most of the money generated by the event center will go to paying hockey players, coaches, and team owners or entertainers for special events. Those people typically live outside of Henderson and thus will take the money back to their home city to spend. Therefore, it is likely the event center will take revenue away from the city, not add to it. History is full of examples of cities subsidizing sports stadiums because of the glowing projections of financial benefits to the city. There is about a paragraph and a half that will be added to back up to the record. Are there two in there? Okay.
Yes.
My computer just died. You want to read one? Do you mind? Can you see it? I don't know why. We have two more that were sent in. There it is. Well, I don't have them. They're showing my inbox. So you might have to read them.
So there's one from James Smerick. Dear City of Henderson, council members, why are you so afraid of democracy? Concerned citizens acted in good faith and had questions about whether public money and assets should be given to police private business. There were concerns over by the neighbors that live in Green Valley Ranch, since this body sought fit to ignore those concerns and close their voices up. Citizens sought relief under provisions set forth in the Nevada Constitution to circulate an initiative petition, as is their right. The intent of the petition is very clear, as is in the council intent. The council continues to act in bad faith and rush to speed up this project while this challenge is still pending. Why won't the city respect the voters and allow them to vote on this issue on the ballot? If the city is so confident of its support, surely they believe it will pass. What are you afraid of? Remember who you represent.
Yeah, I've got Michelle's. Right, Michelle Stella?
Michael Stella.
Okay, so the next one's from Michael Stella, and it's on S1, Michael Stella 89012. Another top priority for me is community engagement, which encourages transparency within our government. One of the reasons that Henderson is a premier city is that our citizens want to be involved in working with their local government. I want to focus on communication between residents, businesses, and City Hall. I plan on personally leading that effort by bringing back monthly town hall meetings, speaking to civic organizations, nonprofits located in our city, and incorporating a targeted digital communication plan that can be accessed by all. This quote is directly from Deborah March's campaign website when she ran for the office of mayor of the city of Henderson. She ran on transparency, she ran on good governance and cooperation with the public. It is disappointing to see that she has turned her back on these promises. On February 13th, the state of the city turned Knights pep rally was when the residents of the city learned that the city was giving up a public site for a private enterprise. The very next day, on February 14th, the City of Henderson Twitter page responded to a comment I left regarding the decision to use the pavilion site as a site for the arena. The response I received was, "We talked to the Knights about a number of locations in Henderson. The team loved the family-friendly feel of Green Valley. Since when does the private sector get to decide that they want a public facility and the city just gives it to them? If this is the model we are to follow now in Henderson, where the ultra rich like Bill Foley get to pick and choose what they want, maybe we can give the Henderson Multi-Gen Center to the MGM International so that the Vegas Aces can have a place for their minor league team to play and only allow the public to use the facility 37 times a year. On March 9th, the city of Henderson held an informational community meeting on the future of the pavilion. While the meeting was well intentioned, it offered no real answers, but instead inspired more questions. Perhaps the most troubling part of this meeting was who was running it and who was there to represent the city. Not a single representative of the city that was running the meeting was an elected official. No one in that room had a single vote cast their way, and not a single person in that room could be held directly accountable to the public at the ballot box. This is a disgrace. If Deborah March had run on being a transparent government figure, why was she not in attendance? Why did she not insist any other member of the elected city council be present? That is not transparency, and that is not good governance. But once again, it showed that Mayor Deborah March does not stay true to her word. It showed that her campaign promises were meaningless. It is hard to put into words how tone deaf the city is. From the speeches at City Hall against the arena, to protests held at the pavilion, to a petition that garnered more than enough signatures, the city has proved it is unwilling to listen to their constituents. There's one more paragraph, and that will be added into the record. And you read James Merrick's, right?
I did.
So I just made a Zinn.
It's just Joyce.
The next is from Joyce Zinn, and that is at 89012. The mayor and city council continue to disrespect and ignore their constituents at every turn. Your lack of morals continues to amaze me. Recently, the city of Henderson city clerk's office accepted the submission of the petition from the Henderson Coalition for Responsible Government. I find it suspicious that the signatures on the petition were validated, even though the petition was supposedly found to be insufficient. Why would the city waste the manpower and money, something they seem to excel at, lately, validating the signatures if the petition were insufficient in the first place? Why even pursue the validation task? That, to me, says the city was again digging and searching for any possible reason to stop this petition in the voice of the residents. I hear and read in this news over and over differing reasons for the certificate of insufficiency. Maybe the mayor, council, and PR department can meet and agree in advance next time as to what their PR mantra is going to be, so at least you are all singing the same tune when it's released to the press. You continue to disappoint daily. I would think even those in favor of the arena would or should begin to question your underhanded and obvious tactics. If not, they should take a closer look. The methods the council mayor use may come to bite them someday too. Joyce Zinn. And that, let me make sure that's all we have here. That's all right. So that's all I have.
Thank you. Madam Deputy City Clerk, have we received any comments or requests to speak versus via WebEx? Thank you. Mr. Derrick, are there any changes to the agenda?
Mayor Pro Tem, there are no changes.
I will entertain. Pardon? Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
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 That was the mayor.
What's that?
That was the
mayor. Mayor Pro Tem, all members of the council voted in favor of Councilman Stewart's motion, and that motion carries.
Mayor Pro Tem, the first item is S1, review of city clerk certificate of insufficiency on the initiative petition filed by Henderson Coalition for Responsible Governance. Your recommendation is to approve.
Sorry. Mayor and Council, for the record, Sabrina Mercadante, City Clerk. On May 18th, 2020, the Henderson Coalition for Responsible Government filed with my office an affidavit of intent to circulate a petition to place on the November 2020 general election ballot an initiative asking the city's voters to enact an ordinance amending the city charter. The proposed ordinance would amend the city's charter to read, "The city of Henderson is hereby prohibited from contributing, investing, or lending any of its revenue or assets or those of its taxpayers for an American Hockey League arena / Henderson Event Center at the Henderson Pavilion." On June 25th, 2020, the coalition submitted the initiative petition to my office. It is my duty to verify that the initiative petition meets certain procedural requirements specified in Chapter 295 of the Nevada Revised Statute. That includes verifying that the petitions are signed by the required number of registered voters and that the petition and required affidavits are in the proper form. Upon receiving the initiative petition, I worked with the Clark County Register of Voters to determine if the initiative petition was signed by the required number of voters. On June 29, 2020, the Clark County Register of Voters confirmed that the initiative petition contained 2,936 signatures of registered voters, meeting the minimum requirements of 2,117, or 50% or more of the number of voters who voted at the last preceding city election. Upon receiving the initiative petition, I conferred with the city attorney, and together we reviewed it for compliance for the other mandatory requirements specified in Chapter 295 of the Nevada Revised Statute. In the course of that review, we determined that the initiative petition lacked a description of effect. A mandatory requirement of NRS 295-009, which rendered the initiative petition procedurally deficient. As a result, on July 1st, 2020, I issued a certificate of insufficiency to the coalition, informing them that the initiative petition does not meet the mandatory requirements of the statute, therefore would not be considered by the City Council or forward for inclusion on the November 2020 ballot. My letter to the coalition informed them that they could request a review of my determination that the initiative petition is procedurally insufficient by making a written request within 2 days, as specified in NRS 295-210. On July 2nd, I received a written request from the coalition for the City Council to review the certificate of insufficiency. Upon receiving the coalition's request, I worked with the city attorney and the city manager to call the special meeting in order to conduct the review. With that, I will turn the presentation over to Mr. Vosco to outline the legal basis for issuance of the certificate of insufficiency.
Thank you, Sabrina. Mayor and Council, for the record, Nick Vosco, city attorney. The Nevada Constitution provides that the citizens of the state have the power to propose by initiative petition statutes and amendments to statutes and to enact or reject them at the polls. The Nevada Constitution also authorizes the legislature to provide by law rules and procedures that facilitate the initiative petition process. To that end, the Nevada legislature has prescribed certain procedural requirements that must be met in order to qualify an initiative petition for the ballot. As Mrs. Mercadante stated earlier, one of those requirements is that the initiative petition must contain a description of effect, which must appear on each signature page of the petition. This requirement is set forth in NRS 295-009. The initiative petition submitted by the Henderson Coalition for Responsible Government does not contain a description of effect. The fact that the initiative petition lacks a description of effect is not a technicality or a mere formality that can be overlooked. Nor is the description of effect requirement some form of bureaucratic red tape that can be ignored. The Nevada Supreme Court has made clear that a description of effect is a required procedural element. We can go to the next slide. It is intended to ensure that people understand what the initiative will actually do before they sign the petition, thereby preventing voter confusion and promoting informed decision making. In a long line of cases, the Supreme Court of Nevada has emphasized, go to the next slide, the importance of the description of effect, and has even stated that the failure to include a description of effect is deceptive and misleading. The description of effect ensures truth in advertising as signatures are gathered for the petition and acts as a counterbalance to the right of the circulators to engage in political free speech. It is also clear from the case law that the actual text of the statute or ordinance proposed by the petition does not constitute the description of effect required by NRS 295-009. That's shown here. Let me give you an example of an initiative petition that meets this requirement. Next slide, please. This one happens to be a statewide initiative petition that was recently filed with the Nevada Secretary of State that proposes to amend the Nevada Constitution. Note that the petition contains not only the proposed constitutional language, but also a description of effect. It's worth noting that several people have provided public comments to the City Council in recent meetings, stating that they were misled by the circulators of the initiative petition about its nature and effect. A couple examples of those statements are in your backup for this item. It's also worth noting that the initiative petition contains 175 signatures that were crossed out or interlineated. It's not clear if this was done by the signatories themselves because they changed their mind about supporting the petition, or if this was done by the petition circulators in an effort to self-verify voter registration. I raise these examples not to assert that they are true or to accuse the circulators of intentionally misleading anyone. But it highlights the fact that the description of effect requirement serves a critically important purpose to ensure that would-be signers are fully informed about the effects of the petition, and also to protect the circulators themselves from accusations that they misled anyone that signed the petition. So in short, the failure of the initiative petition to contain a description of effect as required in NRS 291-009 renders the petition procedurally insufficient. As a technical matter, it also means that the signatures on the petition are invalid. Therefore, it was my recommendation to the city clerk, and now it's my recommendation to you, that the initiative petition be determined to be procedurally invalid. And I ask that you approve the certificate of insufficiency issued by the city clerk. It's also worth noting that the city council's approval of the certificate of insufficiency constitutes the final administrative determination on this procedural issue. If it so chooses, the coalition may file a petition for judicial review challenging your determination. So with that, I'm happy to answer any questions about item S1 and the certificate of insufficiency.
This is Deborah, Mayor Mark. Can I ask a question?
And I don't know if we want to, before you get started, Mayor, I don't know if we want to hold off on the questions until after Mr. Dalrymple has a chance to make his comments on behalf of the coalition or not. I'll leave that up to you.
Well, this is just one question with regards to the one of the letters that came in that spoke to the insufficiency of our actions. Could you maybe clarify that this is a local petition and not a state petition?
Yes. Ms. Haley sent a letter and she pointed to NRS 295-061. That statute essentially allows for a challenge, provides for a process of challenging the description of the effect or lack thereof prior to the committee obtaining signatures. The statute here is pretty complex, and one of the things you've got to know about it is that it divides the requirements into those that apply to statewide initiatives, those that apply to countywide initiatives, and those apply to city initiatives. And the particular provision she's citing to only applies to statewide initiative petitions. There is no way for the city to challenge the description of effect or the lack of description of effect before they go out and get signatures. In fact, the time to do that is now, which is what we're doing tonight. Does that answer your question, Mayor?
Yes, thank you.
I'd like to ask if a representative from Henderson Coalition for Responsible Government wishes to speak at this time.
He is on the line.
Yes, I would love to speak. Thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, appreciate it. Thank you so much. My name is John Dalrymple. I'm pleased to be here today on behalf of the Henderson Coalition for Responsible Government and to represent friends and neighbors and concerned citizens throughout Henderson and certainly in the Green Valley Ranch area. Mayor March, Councilwoman Romero, Councilman Mars, Councilman Shaw, Councilman Stewart, thank you for this opportunity to speak on behalf of this group. I'd also like to thank the administration and the team for making this happen. With special recognition to the city clerk and her staff and the technical team, thank you. Due to the nature of this presentation, I would like to ask that I be given 15 minutes to present our case. I'll try to conclude sooner, Is that acceptable?
Yes, it is.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. As you know, I am not an attorney, but I do have an understanding of the law. I am a citizen of the city, a registered voter, and today I represent a completely grassroots organization that's made an effort to put an initiative on the ballot in November. Let me preface my remarks by stating that I believe there's great value in a difference of opinion. And just because we don't agree with you on this issue, nor do we see eye to eye, that doesn't mean that we don't respect you or we don't like you. To present our case, I'll discuss our purpose, followed by a timeline that led us to develop the petition in an effort to give voice to the people. I will then address the petition language, which we believe is sufficient, and we believe what your interpretation of the law and the language is incorrect. To do so, allow me to share my screen with you now. There we go. Hopefully you can see that. Again, my friends, this is our response to the certificate of insufficiency. The purpose of our petition is to bring this issue of an arena event center at the Patterson Pavilion site to a simple vote of the people. Nothing more, nothing less. It is our understanding that the majority of citizens believe that projects of this magnitude should be voted upon. And all we are asking for is to let the people of our city vote on an issue that would have a huge impact on them. Now, to understand this, let's examine the timeline of events. February 13th, State of the City Address, Mayor March. On February 13th, in the State of the City Address, you showed a video with the Golden Knights helmet dropping on the Henderson Pavilion and destroying it. You had speakers from the Golden Knights organization state, in referring to an arena that would replace the pavilion, it's going to be built. As you can see from this quote from State Senator Keith Ricard, in response to this, he said there was a video that was produced that showed a helmet crushing the pavilion. This was literally going in their backyard and they knew nothing about it. And yet it appears to be pretty much a foregone conclusion at this point. We believe that you, your team, and your council members struck a private deal with the Golden Knights organization, a business entity, long before you announced it on February 13th. This allowed you to carefully plan, construct, and orchestrate a public event that resembled a pep rally. It was essentially a done deal at that point in time, as articulated by the Golden Knights executive. At that time, no one in the impacted community or in the city at large knew anything about the plans or the commitments that you and your team and your council members had made to put an arena at the Henderson Pavilion site. Your actions clearly told the community that their voice didn't matter, that your self-interest and the self-interest of those around you and your desire to partner with a professional sports organization was more important than the people you're supposed to represent. You did not seek community input, and your actions showed a complete disregard for the voice of the people, not just the impacted area, but the people throughout all of Henderson. At that point in time, you lost the trust and the confidence of the people, and you have made this an extremely divisive issue in our community and in our city. And since that rollout on February 13th, you have continued along that path. And you have also been aided by a pandemic that has restricted public in-person access and comment. Moving forward, February 18th, City of Henderson Council meeting. Several residents voiced their opposition to any bond funds being used to construct an AHL arena. Many concerns were brought forth regarding the facility, including increased traffic congestion, negatively impacting adjacent neighborhoods, inadequate parking, lack of transparency regarding the facility, the location of funding. It was our observation, and it continues to be our observation, that those who spoke in opposition at this meeting and many others were treated with passive indifference. We question why, and we believe it was because you already committed to a private deal and public comment was only for show. So the voice of the people was being ignored. March 3rd, several additional residents voiced their opposition. Additional comments were brought forth regarding the facility, including incompatibility with neighboring residential area, better locations elsewhere in the city, use of PAC taxpayer dollars to fund the project, and the uncertainty of who owns and controls the arena. At this meeting, there was no difference in your demeanor. Those who spoke in opposition were treated again with passive indifference, and the voice of the people continued to be disregarded and ignored, which took us to the meetings that you held on March 9th. Sun City McDonald Ranch presentation from Blake Apgar at the Review Journal. Some residents shouted questions at the end of the presentation. I hope they don't rush into something like this, said Anthony Galwick, who lives within walking distance of the pavilion. That's the main thing. Don't just say we're going to do it and then shove it down our throats. Continuing at that meeting, Blake Apgar reported, tonight is about listening. He, Assistant Manager Robert Kerr, said, we don't have all the answers. Kerr did not discuss the anticipated cost of the venue, but Mayor Deborah March has said the city would pay half of the arena with up to $40 million in public money. Henderson spokeswoman Kathleen Richards said the mayor's estimate was premature and the cost had not been determined. Note, many members of our coalition met with the administrative staff. They were told a similar story. The city would be using $40 million or more in public money to fund the arena slash event center, and the Knights would put in the matching amount. But where was the voice of the people in this? It was not sought after, nor was it heard. So let's fast forward. May 14th, I came to the city office myself to have a conversation with the city clerk to turn in the petition or to amend it, to verify the language. The offices were closed. The offices had been closed for 6 weeks or more. Nothing you could do about it, nothing I could do about it. That was just the way it was. But the opportunity to have the conversation as to what that language looked like didn't happen because time became of the essence. We had to collect signatures by a certain date. May 18th, first day the city offices were open. I took the petition to the city clerk and it was stamped and received at 8:16 a.m. Now that date's particularly important because you voted to approve bond money the following day on May 19th, a day after you knew there would be a pending ballot initiative. Again, the voice of the people was disregarded. Our project went forward from May 18th through June 23rd. We gathered signature in the face of heat, weather, wind, and some people that treated us poorly. The petition language is on each signature page, and we believe that it covers not only the subject, but also it covers the effect. Over 3,000 signatures were gathered in the face of that pandemic in a matter of 36 days. From June 23rd through June 25th, signature verification took place by members of the Coalition for Responsible Government. They went through each signature individually and attempted to verify before they were turned in, so we didn't give you something that didn't work. June 25th, the signatures were turned into the city for verification and approval. June 25th through June 29th, the signatures were verified and approved by the city of Henderson, Clark County, and the Secretary of State. Following the signatures being verified on July 1st, the city responded with your certificate of insufficiency, stating that your petition does not contain a description of effect on any page of the petition. On June 2nd, we replied, the Henderson Coalition for Responsible Government, we adamantly disagree with your assessment that our petition is procedurally insufficient. So let's examine the language. And thank you, City Attorney, for your presentation. We may not see eye to eye or disagree with your or agree with your interpretation of the law. Thank you. The City of Henderson is hereby prohibited from contributing, investing, or lending any of its revenue or assets or those of its taxpayers for an America Hockey League arena slash event center at the Henderson Pavilion. Now we know the language is not perfect. We're not a group of attorneys. This is a completely grassroots effort. We know there's even a typo in that language, which should tell you about the grassroots effort that has gone forth to support this and put it together. We believe that this language covers the subject and the effect adequately, and every attorney and judge that we've shown it to has said that it's sufficient. Okay, so what does it take? NRS 295.009, petition requirements. It must embrace one subject, must include description of effect. We don't dispute that. The one subject, the funding of an AHL arena slash event center at the Henderson Pavilion site. The effect, the city of Henderson would be prohibited from funding an AHL arena slash event center at the Henderson Pavilion. I don't know if it could get much clearer than that, but that's it. Now, were those blended? They were in the same paragraph, if you will, that was found at the top of every page of every signature gathering sheet. We discussed that with people that were signing the pavilion, we wanted to make it clear what the effect was, and that's how we went about it. Now, consider the case from the Las Vegas Taxpayer Accountability Committee versus the City of Las Vegas, decided on May 28th, I think, 2009, states this. The Supreme Court considered whether a city council could on its own refuse to place the measure on the ballot because they did not believe it was substantively valid. In that case, the City of Las Vegas did not dispute that the ballot committee had all the procedural requirements done, like the signatures, like we've done. Ultimately, the Nevada Supreme Court said that if a city council or other local governing body believes that a proposed ballot measure is substantively invalid, despite complying with procedural requirements and receiving sufficient signatures, then it must file an action in the appropriate district court seeking declaratory, injunctive, or other relief to prevent the measure's placement on the ballot. A city council may not simply refuse to place the measure on the ballot. In our case, the City of Henderson acknowledges that we have met the procedural requirements to be placed on the ballot, having collected more than enough signatures. The City Council disputes the petition's description of effect, which is a substantive challenge. Thus, the City needs to follow the Nevada Supreme Court's instruction that it has a ministerial duty to place the measure on the ballot. If it wants to challenge the description of effect, the law is clear. You must file a lawsuit and cannot refuse to put it on the ballot. We believe that if you vote against this and deny this petition, you are not in compliance with the law. Now, that's our interpretation. Obviously, you have a different one. But let us move forward and really get to the heart of the issue. What are we asking for? We do not consider your adversaries. We consider your friends. We don't agree on this. And we've asked you time and time again to reconsider this plan. Because of the deal that you've cut, we believe you can't reconsider this plan. But we're going to ask you to reconsider your assessment of procedural insufficiency. It is our request that you reinstate the position and the 2,936 verified signatures. Then we ask you to move this forward to the ballot in November. It's a simple ask. And we ask that you let the people of Henderson decide. It's simply that. It's a vote. That's all we're asking for. Let me conclude at that point in time. I really, truly appreciate the opportunity to have this conversation with you, to state our case. And that is it. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Dalrymple. Are there any other spokespeople that would like to speak?
I don't believe so.
Okay, thank you. I think it would be prudent to have our city attorney to respond to some of the items mentioned.
Sure, a couple of things. Mr. Dalrymple mentioned the Las Vegas taxpayer case and indicated that case was informative here and that we should have. You should reject the certificate insufficiency based on that case. That case is very different from this one. In that case, the City of Las Vegas actually issued a certificate of sufficiency because there was a description of effect and it met all the procedural requirements. Despite issuing that, the City Council in Las Vegas then decided just not to put it on the ballot. And the court said that was improper. Here, we have made the determination that procedurally this is deficient. Because it's procedurally deficient, it cannot go to the ballot. So it's a wholly different case. A couple other things to note. Some of the other themes I heard were the group certainly doesn't like the project and that they're unhappy with the process. None of those, of course, are legal arguments, and we're really here tonight about the law. I think we can all kind of admire the effort and resolve the coalition put into this initiative petition. It's not a process that's for the faint of heart. It is not easy. But the procedural requirements are stringent for a reason. They're there to make sure that people are informed about what they're signing. And that's the whole point of the description of effect requirement. It's so important that the description of effect requirement is the very first provision in statutory scheme. It applies to every single type of initiative petition, whether it's statewide, county, or state. That highlights its importance. Let's see, what else? I think there were some accusations made that this was a done deal even prior to the state of the city. And I guess what I would highlight is between December and now, we've had at least 22 hearings on various items related to this matter. Everything from the agreements with the Golden Knights on this deal to the bonds, whether to issue the bonds, how it would be financed, including use of redevelopment funds. More than 20 different items have been on the agenda. So I think it's a stretch to say it hasn't been transparent. There's been lots of opportunity. So with that, I'm happy to answer any questions, further questions on S1.
Any discussion from the council? Any questions?
Yes.
Nick, what in your opinion would, what's that make this, why is it insufficient? What information is missing that would make it sufficient?
A description of effect. It's very clear from the law that the text of the proposed ordinance itself does not constitute the description of effect. You have to have a short, succinct description in layman's terms of what this would do. I think by Mr. Dalrymple's own admission, this is probably no model of clarity in terms of what it would do. In fact, I think the coalition advertised this position as preventing the city from moving forward with the construction of the event center. But yet, as we'll talk about under item S3 a little more, that's not the way the law works. The law works on a prospective basis, not a retroactive basis. And so it's not at all clear that this petition, even if it got on the ballot and was approved by the voters, would have any effect on the Henderson Event Center project. There are lots of questions about how this thing should be read. Does it prohibit the city from selling the site and the improvements? Can the city partner with a group other than the American Hockey League, who actually isn't our partner, but one of their member teams is? The language of the petition itself is poorly worded, and there's lots of ambiguity there. That there's lots of questions about how it should be read.
Any other questions? Not really a question, just a statement, I guess, from the heart. I think everybody in this room, everybody on WebEx, pretty much everybody that has anything to do with this issue of the arena knows my position, and it's been pretty adamant and it's been steady for the last 5 months in the opposition. However, I'm really torn with this one because this really isn't, in my mind, per se, about the arena itself, the location, or the time, given the COVID pandemic that we are in. So that's been my position to date. What we're talking about, if I understand correctly, is specifically a legal issue. And I would be hard-pressed to vote against what our city attorney is telling us, even though my position on this issue is very clear. I just am very hard pressed to go against the legal advice, legal counsel received from me. So I'm really in a tough position on that one, but so be it. Thank you.
Mr. Shaw?
I feel that, one, we have to take the advice of our city attorney, follow what the statute says, you know, basically, Dalrymple's comments reminds me of one of my college athletic coaches. I love you, but you haven't run enough wind sprints. No. And I'm going to beat you up a little bit more, just a little bit more, recognizing that every one of us sitting here have been through an election, and we were elected by the people to do what we think is best. That's why they elected us, is to do what we think is best. And that's what we're doing. We understand the facts, know how the money's being spent. We think it's best for the city, at least I do. And so, you know, based on that, that's why I've moved forward with this. I think it's going to be a great advantage for the city. It's going to be, you know, a real asset for the citizens of this city. And that's what they elected me to do. That's why I've supported this. So when I look at the facts, this is a legal issue that we're voting on today. I have to take the advice of our city attorney.
Any other comments? Then I'll entertain a motion.
I'll make that motion.
Motion to approve. All in favor, say aye.
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 Mayor Pro Tem, all members of the council voted in favor of Councilwoman Romero's motion, and that motion carries.
Mayor Pro Tem, the next item is S2, authorization by city council for the city attorney to commence or defend litigation regarding initiative petition. Your recommendation is to approve.
Bring that presentation again. Slide. Next slide. Mayor and council, again, for the record, Nick Vosco, city attorney. In addition to the procedural defects of the initiative petition that we discussed in the prior item, the initiative petition submitted by the Henderson Coalition for Responsible Government suffers fatal defects as a matter of law as well. The power to enact statutes and ordinances through the initiative process is limited to legislative and not administrative acts. Simply put, legislative acts are those that lay down a rule of conduct or course of policy for the guidance of citizens or their officers. Impermissible legislative acts, on the other hand, are acts that execute on previously enacted laws or direct a decision that has already been made or is already delegated to the government. This last case referred to here, is called the Reno train trench case. And it's very similar factually to our case. Next slide. In the late 1990s, the Reno City Council decided to lower the railroad tracks that run through downtown Reno. The city entered into agreements with the Union Pacific Railroad, completed an environmental impact study, awarded a design and engineering contract, and adopted a $200 million plus financing. A group of citizens known as Citizens for a public train trench vote submitted an initiative petition that proposed that the city of Reno shall not construct a depressed train trench within the existing railroad right-of-way through the central portion of the city of Reno. Litigation ensued between the city of Reno and this group, and the district court entered an order declaring the initiative petition unconstitutional as an administrative act. On appeal, the Nevada Supreme Court agreed, finding that the initiative petition was administrative in nature because it attempted to prohibit the construction of a project, not set policy. The initiative petition proposed a law of special character, not a law of general character and applicability. As a result, the train trench petition was deemed unconstitutional and prohibited from appearing on the ballot. Like the train trench case, the initiative petition submitted by the Henderson Coalition for Responsible Government is administrative in nature and not legislative. It seeks to prohibit the construction of a specific project at a specific location. It proposes a law of special character, not a law of general applicability. It dictates administrative detail. It does not establish policy. As a result, it is unconstitutional and cannot be placed on the ballot. Approval of this item S2 authorizes my office to commence or defend litigation in order to prohibit placement of the initiative petition on the November 2020 ballot because it is constitutionally infirm. Finally, I want to make clear that the unconstitutional nature of the initiative petition was not taken into consideration when the city issued the certificate of insufficiency we talked about in the previous item. The procedural deficiencies and the constitutional deficiencies of the initiative petition are separate and distinct issues. This item allows my office to challenge the constitutionality of the initiative petition if it becomes necessary to do so. So with that, I'm happy to answer any questions on this item.
Questions? I will entertain a motion.
I might comment on this as well. Nick, wouldn't that be the whole process of determining if it is constitutionally set forth correctly?
So what this item will do, it will allow me to file a pre-election challenge to the ballot, to the initiative. And I will be able to raise all of these constitutional issues. In the course of that, I will ask for an injunction preventing this from going on the ballot.
Is there a trigger to that?
No, I can file that now at any time. There is a trigger on the previous item. So the coalition has the ability on the previous item, on the certificate of insufficiency, to challenge that in court by filing a petition for judicial review. But those are really two different matters.
That's what I'm trying to make sure you all understand.
Correct.
We've got the procedural and we've got the constitutional issues.
Correct.
And so the last item we heard, would, if the coalition chose to move forward with a suit, that would be specifically just to the procedural manner in which the petition was.
They would have the burden to both plead and prove that they met all the procedural requirements.
What if, for instance, and I'm just trying to get this all out here.
Yep.
So we all understand what's going on. What if, for instance, the judge ruled in favor? Is that what, is that why you're doing what you're talking about with S2?
Exactly. Independent of those procedural issues, there are these constitutional deficiencies. And so this item, no matter what happens with the certificate of insufficiency, allows me to pursue those claims.
Well, I, for one, I'm just really sorry it's come to this. I live right next door to this, and every day, so there's folks out there with the petitions working hard in the heat, wind, taking abuse, and I mean, it's unbelievable to me their care and their concern for their community. It was admirable, and they should be recommended for, you know, working so hard for something that they believe be just and fair. So it truly is a hardworking group, good people with good motives.
I agree.
And it's just terrible that it's come to this.
Like I said earlier, the process is not easy. The groups that tend to be successful at this tend to be well-funded, well-organized. They don't tend to be grassroots groups because procedures are pretty strict. The statute is pretty, it's a difficult statute to fully understand. So it's not an easy process.
Thank you.
Any other comments, questions? I will now entertain a motion.
I'll move to approve.
All in favor?
Aye.
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 Mayor Pro Tem, all members of the council voted in favor of Councilman Shaw's motion, and that motion carries.
Mayor Pro Tem, the last item is S3, presentation of financial effect of the initiative petition filed by the Henderson Coalition for Responsible Government. Recommendation is to approve.
Mayor and Council, for the record, Sabrina Mercadani, City Clerk. NRS 295-205 provides that after receiving an initiative petition, the City Clerk shall consult with the City Council, determine if the initiative may have an anticipated financial effect on local government if approved by the voters. Included in your backup for this item is a document outlining the possible financial effect the initiative petition submitted by the Henderson Coalition for Responsible Government might have on the city. I emphasize might because the wording and structure of the initiative petition make it very difficult to determine the financial effect. As noted in the document, as a general rule,
new ordinances and laws operate prospectively only, not retroactively. As a result, even if the initiative petition is included on the November 2020 ballot, it should have no effect on previously approved ordinances, plans, and contracts related to the transformation of the Henderson Pavilion into a multi-purpose arena known as the Henderson Event Center. Nonetheless, assuming that despite the law, a court determines the initiative petition applies retroactively, the financial impact document outlines the various ordinances, contracts, project agreements, bonds, expected economic benefits, tax revenue, community benefits, operational savings, and other expectations that could be negatively impacted. Upon approval of this item, I will post a copy of the fiscal impact document on the city clerk's website as required by NRS 295.205. With that, Mr. Vosco, and I will answer any questions related to this item.
Any questions?
What is it we're exactly approving or not approving? What is it?
So the statute requires when the city clerk receives an initiative petition that she prepare this financial impact statement. That requirement is there at the beginning of the process, no matter whether we're contesting either the procedural side or the substantive side.
So in essence, we are just fulfilling our procedural.
Correct. It's just this is another aspect of ensuring that the public is fully aware of what this thing will do. This is the part we play. The description of effect and the petition is the part that the petitioners commit.
Thank you.
I will now entertain a motion. Motion, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Mayor Pro Tem, all members of the council voted in favor of Councilwoman Romero's motion, and that motion carries.
Are there any further comments from members of the council?
Next on your agenda is a public comment. This time is set aside for our second public comment section. At this time, remote participants should begin submitting questions or comments via real-time text through WebEx or indicate that you would like to speak on this item. You may also submit questions and comments via email at cityclerk@cityofhenderson.com.
Madam City Clerk, have we received any comments or questions via email or comment card?
No, I'm just giving them a few seconds to see if anybody's been submitting. This may be an announcement. No, I don't have not received anything during City Clerk.
Madam Deputy City Clerk, have we received any comments or requests via to speak via WebEx?
Yes, Mayor Pro Tem, we have. We received one comment from Jimmy Benzlaw. Says, just want to say thank you for everything you all do for us. I know that not every decision is easy, and no matter what you choose, be upset. It is clear that you all want the best for Henderson, and so far you have done such a great job. I'm thankful for my city and thankful for your leadership.
Any other?
That's it.
Yes. Well then, we'll adjourn this meeting.